Now we are going to start with session 8. It's a symposium on periprosthetic joint infections. I would request Dr. Rajesh Malhotra to come and be the panel master for the same. Among the panelists, Dr. J.V. Srinivas, Dr. Dimple Parekh, Dr. C.S. Yadav, to come upon the panel, please. And I would request the first speaker, Dr. Yuvraj Lakum, to take his talk on from clinical assessment to diagnosis of PJI.
Welcome, good afternoon. I can't see Dr. Dimple Parekh. I suppose he's around. Dr. Srinivas is also missing. Dr. Sanjeev Jain is also not there. So, yeah, please start.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Dr. Manoj, for the invite. My topic today is prosthetic joint infection, clinical assessment and diagnosis. Okay. The definition of PJI is still evolving, and it keeps on evolving. There are so many organizations who are actively participating, and they are giving us now new definition of prosthetic joint infection, the Musculoskeletal Infection Society, consensus, International Consensus Group, AOS, all of them are doing that job. These are some doyens of prosthetic research thing, and I'm proud to say that Dr. Malhotra, Dr. Sancheti, and Dr. Vaidya are part of that consensus group. The idea of the lecture is, since we all know the, what are the tests involved in prosthetic joint infection, I stick to the algorithm, what are the cutoff values, and some myth busters. This is the concept which is called pre-test probability, which has been given by AOS and endorsed by MSIS. Whenever a patient comes to your office, try to, with the symptoms of infection, try to divide that in your mind into a low probable group or a high probable group. A low probable group, you really go low, and a high probable group, you have to be very really fast on that. A low probable group who has only symptoms, no signs and risk factors, and a high probable group is the symptoms with signs and risk factors. Which are these risk factors? Apart from obesity, rheumatoid arthritis, diabetes, there are some other risk factors like prior infection, superficial surgical site infection, operative time which is more than 2.5 hours, immunosuppressive states, bacteremia, and other risk factors. There are some mythbusters also. Smoking doesn't lead to prosthetic joint infection, prude, drains, anticoagulants, they don't lead to PJI. What is the lead? What are the clinical symptoms? Patient normally present with unusual pain, pain which was not there, and sometimes stiffness. And what are the signs? Most of the time, we know the signs, redness, there is warmth, there is swelling, there is painful arc of movement, and there are sometimes obvious signs like sinus tract. Yes, purulence does not prove infection, and it is officially out of new MSIS guideline because of inter-observer reliability and unreliability. And in the era of metal on metal and other adverse reaction, purulence is out of question now. So what do we do when a patient comes to your office who has a high or low probability and you have a good clinical suspicion? We get the first test done, which is called serology, ESR and CRP together. Not ESR, not only CRP, together has good value. In an acute setting, you don't rely on ESR, but CRP more than 100 is a good indication. In a chronic setting, ESR more than 30 and CRP more than 10 is a suspicion. We don't really rely on counts now. They don't count. Procalcitonin, they don't really mind. It is as good as CRP. Negative ESR and CRP almost always rules out infection. In a low probability group, you don't go more than that. In a high probability group, you can just go ahead with that. So next stage is aspiration. When do you decide you need to aspiration? So just don't mind this slide. Positive ESR and CRP, or ESR or CRP, you go for aspiration. And negative ESR and CRP only do an aspiration if you have very high clinical suspicion. And do not aspirate a hip with a low probability, and only either of ESR and CRP is positive. So just don't aspirate each and every knee which you get. What are the essential? With an aseptic precaution, preferably in OT, it should be directly inoculated in culture bottles. Antibiotic free period should be 2 weeks, and culture should be kept at least 14 to 21 days. What do we want to see in the aspiration? We want to send it for culture, synovial fluid WBC, synovial fluid polymorphonuclear count, and synovial fluid biomarkers. The cutoff values are given here. Synovial fluid WBC more than 10,000 and 90% is for acute setting, and chronic setting it is more than 3,000 and 80%. What are the future? Synovial fluid biomarkers, CRP, leukocyte esterase enzyme, and alpha defensin are the future. We can get a CRP done, but LE enzyme and alpha defensin are still not available in India. Synovial CRP is a good thing. LE strip test is a single test which can be done in the office, not done in India. Synoviashare is about to come maybe in India. Combination of both of things are very good. What is role of repeat aspiration whenever you have a discrepancy, whenever you have a dry tap, which is common, and whenever you do a repeat aspiration, do add and MycoF and fungal culture to that. 90% of PGR get diagnosed up to, at this point of time with ESR, CRP, and up to aspiration. With X-ray, we don't do X-ray because it's of no value. Nuclear imaging only when there is dry tap and intermediate diagnosis. Intraoperative diagnosis when it is not the diagnosis has not made it up to this point of time. We don't use Gram stains. Frozen section is controversial, and tissue culture is what we need. And there are essential for that also. No swab, 14 days of antibiotic free period. At least 6 samples, and sample should be preferably taken with a knife at interface. And negative does not rule out infection. Culture negative PGI, role of sonication is a very important tool, but not available in India, and only simple thing. Sonication of the implant is done, which increases the yield and removes the bacteria from its biofilm. So that is the definition of PGI, which is given by Musculoskeletal Society and International Consensus Group. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yuvraj. I know it was a lot of work in a very short time. Come and join us for the panel here. Our next speaker is Dr. Amit Vispati, who is going to talk about antibiotics in arthroplasty. While he's coming, Yuvraj, I might tell you, we have finished a PhD thesis on periprosthetic joint infection, and we have been routinely doing sonication of implants and even the cement spacers we take out. So it's a factually incorrect statement that sonication is not available in India.
So we've been talking about arthroplasty for the last 2 days, and finally we've come down to something really basic, because something as simple as this can spoil the whole surgery. I'm sure you've gone through poetry when you were in school, and you got to remember this. There were 6 honest serving men, and they taught you everything, and that's true of orthopedics itself. You simply got to know what, where, and when, why, how, and who. And if you answer these basic questions, then you probably have all the answers. So whenever you're faced with a dilemma, and particularly of which antibiotic to use, then you got to ask yourself these simple questions, and I'm sure you always have the answers. We're fairly concerned about prosthetic infection because it's the most devastating complication. The costs involved here are very high. On an average, it's 5 to 10 lakh rupees is what a patient might spend in private practice to be bailed out of a prosthetic infection. It can take away 3 months to a year or possibly more out of a human being's life, and certainly it's very debilitating. The question is, to answer the first question, what antibiotics to use? Obviously, the antibiotic use for prophylaxis should be very carefully selected and consistent with current recommendations in literature, taking into account allergies of the patient and the hospital's flora, sensitivity, and resistance pattern. So, of course, it's not enough to be just reading the Journal of Bone and Joint Surgery and saying that's what they recommended there, because it should be specific for your hospital and that particular setting. Agreed that cefazolin and cefuroxim are generally the preferred antibiotics, but it could be different for your hospital. If you've got a patient who's sensitive to penicillin, then you've got to consider clindamycin or vancomycin. That means there's a beta-lactam allergy. Next question, where, when, and how? You administer it in the induction room as soon as IV access is obtained. I know that's very difficult time and again because anesthetists have their own mind and they function very differently from us, but you've got to make sure it's administered within 1 hour prior to skin incision. You may need to consider additional intraoperative doses if the duration of the procedure exceeds 1 to 2 times the antibiotic's half-life, or if there is significant blood loss during the procedure. So how often would we give that? It depends on the antibiotic you've chosen. If you use cefazolin, you repeat the dose every 2 hours. If it's cefuroxim, you repeat it every 3 hours. Clinda and Vanco are repeated every 3 or 6 hours. The duration of the antibiotic should not be more than 24 hours, and you all know that. The problem is that inappropriate antibiotic use, not only will it not prevent your post-op infection, but it might lead to antibiotic resistance, increase the risk of adverse reactions, and will predispose the patient to a further infection and also increase your cost. Use of such an antibiotic will also mask a subsequent infection and may in fact aid the development of a chronic infection. Why do we use an antibiotic? I think that's fairly straightforward and stupid to even show such a slide in an orthopedic community meeting. But we know that patients who develop infections spend a lot of time coming out of them, spend time in intensive care as well. They have increased readmissions, and chances of morbidity and mortality are higher. Now, who gives the antibiotic? Well, of course, it's the anesthetist, but more importantly, ordered by the surgeon at the correct time, and it needs to be documented, especially in these days in terms of medico-legal crisis coming up. There's some role to antibiotic impregnated cements as well, because antibiotics can be administered locally, even in primary surgeries. There are advantages of antibiotic impregnated cement because they lower the incidence of infection, but there can be some disadvantages because some studies, although very old and studies, show that there are higher incidence of resistant organisms coming up. Structural support issues only if they are not premixed by the company and if you add them, and marginal increase in costs. I mean, patients paying so much for the surgery, but the cost increase here is minimal. A very old study now did look at it. There's not a lot of recent literature looking at antibiotic versus non-antibiotic cement, but certainly a prospective control study done 17 years back showed no infections in an antibiotic cement group versus a non-antibiotic cement group. Now, if you did have a patient with an infection, then the question is, which kind of antibiotic are you going to use? And of course, it depends on the kind of the bacterium. Most commonly, you're Staph aureus or Staph epidermidis, but occasionally, you can land up with a fulminating E. coli infection as well. And what, where, when, and how? Of course, it's as per culture sensitivity report, and you do not send them off to just about any random lab near the patient's house. It has to go to a reliable, well-known lab. You don't start the antibiotics until samples have been sent for culture sensitivity. There's false negative about 55% if the patient has been on antibiotics. You may also add antibiotics locally in the form of cement spacers and biocomposites, as many of us have been adding. And once the samples have gone off, you start empirical IV antibiotics, and ideally IV antibiotics for 6 weeks, and then subsequently for further oral antibiotics for 6 or 8 weeks. Most importantly, doses need to be correct, and you may need to consider involving your infectious disease colleagues in the modern world, because we tend to have less and less knowledge of the antibiotics. Specific antibiotics are also added, and especially rifampicin now has an emerging role in orthopedic prosthetic infections. It's particularly good for staph. It has excellent biofilm penetration, but a high resistance if used alone, and you choose to then combine it with ciprofloxacin, doxycycline, or trimethoprim. For MRSA, you've got a feast of antibiotics which now use linezolid, teicoplanin, vanco, and even daptomycin. In culture-negative infections, you have to go by the history. You tend to then use linezolid, vanco, or teicoplanin, or sometimes daptomycin as well. The duration needs to be minimum 6 to 12 weeks or till CRP and ESR are normal, whichever occurs later. Start with a peripheral line, rotate your lines every 3 weeks, and then repeat sampling or cultures. The take-home messages are, of course, IV prophylactic antibiotics to be used for 24 hours. Administer an hour before incision. If you suspect an infection, send cultures, start antibiotics, but hit hard in the correct dose without mercy. And most importantly, your hospital needs to have its own antibiogram so that you use antibiotics appropriately. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Amit. Join us on the dais here. May I now invite my colleague, Dr. Vijay Kumar, to speak about PJI single stage treatment.
On periprosthetic infection single stage revision. Well, periprosthetic infection is a serious challenge for patients, healthcare providers, and it involves a lot of cost. It has been labeled as the last frontier in arthroplasty by Farah Sadat and Javed Parvij in the latest editorial. It is because the number of publications have risen to more than 100-fold in the last decade, focusing on PPI. The basic problem is that of biofilms, which prevent the bacteria from being isolated and from antibiotics acting on them. Of the various treatment options, I am going to discuss on single-stage revision. Well, the gold standard has been till now two-stage revision because it helps you identify the organism, gives you the antibiotic sensitivity, gives you two chances for debridement, the interval period, helps you assess the antibiotic response, and also helps you plan your revision surgery. But there are a few disadvantages with two-stage surgery because the patient has to undergo two surgeries, there's an interval period, the quality of life is quite inferior in the interval period, and there are complications of spacers such as dislocation, instability, and protrusion or contracture. And then there is always the risk of the additional surgery, and it also increases the healthcare costs. And it has also been seen that not all patients undergo the second stage surgery. Parvezi found that around 18% of his patients never underwent a second surgery because they were either unfit for surgery or they died before the second surgery. So coming to the indication, it has to be a diagnosed PJI, which is a chronic infection more than 30 days post-op. it should be done only in immunocompetent patients. The patient should not have major comorbidities. The bone loss should be minimal to moderate, not massive in which you need to require massive allografts or mega prostheses, with healthy soft tissue which permits primary bone closure. And the most important thing, you should be able to isolate an organism, and you should know the antibiotic sensitivity for that organism. Only then the patient can undergo a single stage revision. So coming to the contraindication, it is absolutely contraindicated in patients who have a culture negative PGI, or if there are no appropriate antibiotics, or if there's a high resistant antibiotic, or if the infection is a very, very highly virulent organism such as a MRSA, or it's a polymicrobial infection. In patients who have got systemic sepsis or peripheral vascular disease or immunocompromised with multiple comorbidity, or if they have local factors such as they have been failure of two previous one-stage infection procedures, or if the infection is involving neurovascular bundle, of there is an extensive soft tissue involvement, or if there is a sinus tract with unclear bacterial specifications. Now, it's a standard pre-op workup, but joint aspiration is absolutely important if you want to do a single stage revision. And as has already been told by my previous speaker, the patient should be off antibiotics for 2 weeks, culture has to be done for 2 weeks, repeat aspiration even if it's negative. All this is done so as to have a positive culture with an antibiogram or sensitivity. Then only you can do a single stage revision. The surgical technique is basically two operations in one. In the first part, you go in, remove, do a radical debridement, remove all the foreign particles. This debridement is going to decide whether your operation is going to be successful or not. Once you have debrided it, then you do a thorough lavage. This is a protocol given by Pervezi, in which you lavage with hydrogen peroxide and then a normal saline, and then you put a lot of betadine inside and close the wound, and then you go out of the OT. The patient is again draped, new instruments are used, you re-scrub, and then you do a second lavage, and then you implant the new processes using an antibiotic loaded cement or antibiotic loaded bone graft. The biggest problem with single stage revision was that you could not use cementless implants as you did not have good antibiotic delivery. Now Winker et al. Came up with this antibiotic bone compound, in which he incubated the antibiotic in the bone graft. This could be used for as a carrier for antibiotics, and he has shown that 92% of his patients were free from infection. And you can also use this technique by Whiteside, in which you use intra-articular infusion, or you can use stimulant beads. And now there are results of cementless revision using as single stage also, which have been successful. The results of two stage have been the gold standard. However, these are all level 3 and 4 studies. One stage started in endoclinic, and their results are very good. They do around 85% of patients with one stage, and their result success around 90%. Other authors have also reported both in THR as well as TKR results of 70 to 90% or even 100% infection control. As far as meta-analysis or systemic review is concerned, there are 3 in knee and 3 for 2 for hip, and all of them show that similar or superior outcomes with single stage revision with lower infection rates and superior function. However, these are only in select group of patients, and one should remember to take this in perspective, single stage were done in patients who were, you know, immunocompetent with the organism which had been isolated. They would have done better anyhow. So the need is to have more RCTs. There are no RCTs. Currently, there are 2 RCTs which are recruiting, and we might get evidence from them. One is by the Ortho Carolina Institute in US, and other is from in NHS from the Bristol Hips unit. Once we have the results, then we might have evidence that single stage really works for all patients. Till then, this is another Faris Haddad editorial. He came that single stage revision is a proven technique, but the challenge is to identify patients whom it can be applied and refining our diagnostics to get the organism as well as antibiotic delivery in order to optimize outcomes. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Vijay. Join us on the dais here. May I now invite Dr. Vernon Lee to speak about the two-stage revision in infected TK. I think these two topics, one stage versus two stage, are going to at least remain here till all of us retire from here.
I'd like to thank the organizers for this. Now, there are many ways to skin a cat, but John Insall in 1983 in his, much quoted paper, I said that the two-stage revision remains the gold standards. Now the Swiss have come up with, since there are so many options, the Swiss have come up with it depends on the clinical situation, whether it is one stage or two stage, or you have to, identify the clinical situation. And the two stage, I'll focus on that, is when there's a lot of soft tissue damage, when there's a sinus when there are resistant bugs, that's when you should do a two-stage rather than anything else. Now, if there are non-resistant bugs, you can put a spacer in, and if there are resistant bugs, then you may not need to put a spacer in, but focus on the antibiotics. The standard operating protocol is joint aspiration, as we've heard, smear culture sensitivity, sed rate, CRP. Procalcitonin will help you identify whether it's a bacterial infection or not, but no more information than that. You need to know whether it's bacterial. AG ratio and comorbidities are the other things that you need to do during the workup. The two stages, the first one is the surgical removal of all components, thorough debridement, antibiotic spacer, IV antibiotics for 6 weeks, you need a central line-in, and the oral antibiotics till the markers come down. Then the inflammatory markers are down, debridement, definitive prosthesis, antibiotic cement, IV for 4 weeks, followed by oral for about 8 weeks and even up to 20 weeks. You start oral antibiotics only when the, you know, the wound is dry, when there are no more sinuses, then you start the oral antibiotics. Otherwise, you should keep the IV on. The approach needs to be adequate. We've seen a tibial tubercle osteotomy displayed by Dr. Vijay yesterday. You need to do that if you cannot expose adequately. If the thing comes out and you can see, then you don't need to resort to these extensive exposures. Radical debridement, I don't need to emphasize this, you need to get everything out. Tissue culture, high powered field, the microscopy, it may not be helpful at the time, help you decide at the time, but it's good for documentation in this era of medical legal issues. Sonofragmentation is available, you can buy the equipment online. It helps you break down the glycocalyx and, you know, get a better yield of the bacteria. Spacers are static and articulating. The static spacers are custom made or, you know, pre-mixed, or you can put it, the custom made helps in the greater elution of antibiotics because of the better porosity. That's the picture showing you, you know, making it on the table. You have to do it in two mixes of cement. That's pictures of the same. Articulating spacers, you can now buy them. You can use the autoclaved original ones, you can use a new prosthesis, or you can use the silicone molded ones. Every 40 grams of cement, this is what is recommended, 3.6 grams of tobramycin, 1 to 3 grams of vancomycin, and 2 to 3 grams of kefazolin. Kefazolin acts as a porogen. It increases the porosity of the cement when you're mixing it. So the stages I've already mentioned, surgical removal of everything, and when the inflammatory markers are down, that is when you re-implant the new prosthesis. Rifampicin and MRSA is extremely helpful and is gaining more popularity, but it can be and should be used only when the wound is dry. They say that if you use rifampicin when the wound is still discharging, the efficacy is less. Now, this is what I want to emphasize. The predictors of increased failure after two-stage revisions. There are a couple of papers here. The first two are the most important. When there is increased purulence or if it's an MRSA infection, then, you know, one out of four of these re-revisions or these revisions tend to fail. Other indications of increased or predictors of increased failure are when there's active rheumatoid arthritis, when the AG ratio albumin is down in the patient, diabetes, obesity. Smoking does not cause infection, as one of the previous people said. However, it does decrease the vascularity, and everybody knows that. So that is important. And this is paradoxical, I should say, a low WBC count. This indicates that the immune status is down. So a low WBC count may not mean that there's no infection. It may mean that the patient's immune system is not working too well. So in conclusion, scientific literature reviews suggest that 5 to 10 year survivorship is about 75 to 90%. There are various papers, and it depends on how you look at it and what is a failure. You know, if you're very critical, then one out of four of these cases, if you analyze, tend to fail. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Please join us here on the dais. Our next speaker is Dr. B.D. Chatterjee, who is going to talk about management of discharging wounds. The discharging is a rather cryptic word here. I don't know what it is meant, whether it's the fungal hyphae or blood or pus or any discharge whatsoever.
Thank you, and I'd like to express my thanks to Dr. Manoj for the kind invitation. Now, a draining wound is sometimes seen after a total knee arthroplasty, and while it's an inconvenience and a nuisance, but it need not always be the harbinger of a disaster. However, prolonged drainage is associated with increased risk of infection, as is evident from literature. So I think it's useful to know when to expect a patient to have wound problems, and these are the conditions: diabetes, malnutrition, obesity, rheumatoids, people on on immunosuppressive agents, psoriasis, and if the patient has been operated multiply before. What are the things we can do to prevent the wounds from giving problems? The first is that we should avoid raising skin flaps. As you can see from the top photograph, this is not something we should do. And the closure really should be absolutely watertight, because that can a leakage from the closure of the capsule can actually lead to a problem. And that is why I think a lot of the time I actually insist on doing the closure of the capsule myself. Now, what are the determining factors? If you see load case paper, then what is important is the two things which are important: whether it is in outside the capsule or it is intra-articular, and whether there is a presence or absence of infection. Now, how to detect these? In fact, Lotkin's paper has actually classified, and there are four types, again, depending on the location or the plane of the collection and the nature of the collection. How to know whether this collection or the drainage that you're getting is infected or not? Now, if there are systemic signs which accompany this phenomenon, that such as fever, tachycardia, and laboratory parameters which indicate, then that's a very clear suggestion of infection. The local signs are erythema, warmth, and I think one very important sign is if the sinus is located away from the incision line, then that is a very clear indicator of an infected collection. So when would you wait and do conservative management? That is when you get a decreasing volume of, and the nature of the fluid remains serosanguineous or bloody, when the absence of clinical signs of infection. And of course, you must culture this, and if your cultures are negative, you can afford to wait. What are the factors in conservative treatment? The first, of course, you have to do sterile dressings. Prophylactic antibiotics are recommended in literature. Limit the joint movement. You must stop anticoagulants if you're using any, and you could actually aspirate the joint, either just to get a diagnosis or to decompress the joint. Operative management, indications are increasing volume of drainage. If there's a nature of the fluid is purulent, and if there are persisting signs of infection, positive cultures, and if you encounter pus inside the joint, then you have to wash it out thoroughly and do a poly exchange. Post-operative management, what is recommended is that if the cultures are negative, you have to still give 3 weeks of antibiotics. If it's positive, then give antibiotics for 6 weeks. You should use drains in these cases, and you must delay the range of motion exercises until the local signs settle. What does the literature say about the results? If the cultures are negative, then there are very, very gratifying results of joint lavage and prosthesis retention. However, it drops to 50% when there is an established infection with positive cultures, and it must be done quickly. There's no point in delaying it beyond 4 weeks if you want to retain the prosthesis, and the worst results have been seen with Staph aureus infection. So just a word about skin necrosis. This is sometimes you may encounter, and it may not always be infected. The small areas can be managed conservatively, but the large areas, they require probably the help of a plastic surgeon in some sort of reconstructive and coverage procedure. So in summary, post-operative wound drainage is not common, but it is sometimes seen. I think I need to change that. Avoidance of subcutaneous dissection and watertight capsular closure is absolutely necessary. Conservative treatment is appropriate as long as the discharge is serosanguineous and decreasing. Increasing quantity, nature of or change in the nature of the discharge is an indication for opening the joint and lavage. Joint lavage should be done open, not arthroscopically, and poly exchange is required if there is pus inside the joint. I thank you for a patient hearing.
Thank you. Please come and join us here. And then the last resort, when nothing works. So Dr. Krishna Kiran is going to stand for Dr. Gurwa Reddy and tell us what to do when everything else fails.
Yeah, good afternoon. And I'm pitching in for Dr. Gurwa, and this is results from his center. And we all know that periprosthetic joint infection can be a catastrophic complication for the patient. And the success rate can be variable depending upon the surgeon, the type of organism, the patient host situation. And if you don't succeed in eradicating the infection, then what? That is the premise of this particular talk. And you tried all the debridement, retention of implant, one stage, two stage revision. And if it fails, we are left with three options. You put a patient on long-term antibiotic suppression. You may have to do an arthrodesis, and sometimes, very rarely, an amputation. If you look at the long-term antibiotic suppression, it is aiming to control the infection rather than eradicate it, and must be reserved for elderly and frail patients with a well-fixed prosthesis. And the pathogen must not be that virulent. You must not use it in patients who've got an artificial heart valve. And the results of long-term antibiotic suppression are at best very disappointing, with a failure rate as high as 86% in some of the series. And even in those patients where it is successful, there is a relapse of infection in around 30% of the patient when the antibiotic treatment is discontinued after a long period of success suppression therapy. And we must note that you should not use the antibiotic suppression when you're using a tumor type of prosthesis. It can work in a primary type of situation, but not in a tumor prosthesis. Arthrodesis, by and large, remains the cornerstone of management of these patients. It's indicated in resistant deep infection with loss of soft tissues and extensor mechanism. And the aim is to achieve a painless and stable joint in an optimal position for that particular patient. Several techniques exist, and this particular paper will talk about the Elizarov fixator results in our group of patients. And the outcomes after knee arthrodesis, again, are variable. And although the infection-free evidence is around 85 to 90%, a lot of the patients are dissatisfied with their outcome. And they're able to be independently ambulatory and infection-free, but they're not happy because the range of motion is not existing. Our own experience at Sunshine Hospital between 2009 and 13 is on 30 cases with a mean age of 62.3 years. And the mean surgeries before arthrodesis were ranging from 2 to 6, with 3.5 being the mean surgical procedures. It entailed a primary TKA removal and arthrodesis in 15, after failed first stage revision in 10, and after revision TKA in 5, and this particular paper is published in the Indian Journal of Orthopedics. The technique involved excision of the sinus tract and all the synovial tissue and a meticulous debridement. Implant and all the foreign body and cement particles were removed thoroughly. The bone ends were freshened, was debrided, and pulsatile lavage was done, as Vijay showed. Patella was used as a graft to aid in the healing. Provisional stabilization was done with cross K-wires, and a partial closure of the wound was done, and an Elizarov circular fixator with docking was done using two rings in the femur and two rings in the tibia, and each ring had a minimum of 2 to 3 wires, and sometimes we use Shan's pin in the femoral side. And it's absolutely critical to avoid the neurovascular planes when you're doing this particular procedure. The post-op rehabilitation was full weight bearing as tolerated from the day 2, and the patients were reviewed at 15, 30 and 60 days after the intervention, and sometimes the accordion maneuver was done to achieve better healing. The frame removal was based on radiological and clinical data. Dynamization was done 1 month prior to the planned implant removal, where the rods were loosened, and once the removal of the Elizarov fixator was done, once there was good evidence of clinical and radiological healing. The mean follow-up was 3.8 years. The VAS course was around 4, so the patient had some pain. The SF36 improved, but it was not very good. 2 patients died, and 1 patient had to have an early implant removal due to non-compliance, and 1 transfemoral amputation was done because of failure to eradicate the infection. 92% of the patients had fusion, and there were some patients who required reoperation, which is not uncommon, because of hardware impingement and a stress fracture which required extension of the frame. And recurrence of severe infection in this particular patient warranted amputation. Coming to amputation after failed totally arthroplasty, It is rare, between 0.1 and 0.3% in literature. An average of 5 to 6 surgical procedures and an average of 6 years after the index surgery. So it's a troublesome thing for the patient. And the functional outcome after amputation in post-TKA failure is quite poor when you look at the literature. This was one of my own patients where we had done a hinge, and 4 years later he developed a fulminant fungal infection, and this is the only case where I had to do an amputation. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. So how much time do we have? 10 minutes. Great. 10 minutes is too good. So we can have at least 2 questions for everybody. Starting with Yuvraj.
Yes.
Yuvraj, when you talk about suspicion of infection, does the timing have anything to do with it? I mean, when the patient presents, a patient comes to you with loosening at 1 year. There is pain, there is swelling, there is lysis under the tibial tray. How will you proceed?
Okay, now patient has come at 1 year, but the starting of the symptom and presentation to you is more important. If it is within first month, then you have to consider that as an acute hematogenous maybe. If it is loosening, that it is, the process is going on chronic. So this is a chronic infection which is going on. The procedure for that is, if you rule out all the infection criteria, if it is infected, then you go for 2-stage.
So patient has presented between 9 months and 1 year. ESR is normal, CRP is normal, and you have done a TAP, it's negative. There is loosening and lysis.
That means you have to do a re-aspiration. If that is also dry TAP, then you go for some kind of scan. And if it is suggestive, then you go inside in explaining to the patient, because the definition doesn't mean that you do surgery or you don't do the surgery. Mm-hmm. But you go inside explaining the patient that either it can be infected, we do the
Anybody procedure. On the panel would like to give an opinion about how to proceed and the role of scan? Now he has brought out a question about scan. Krishna?
So I don't think there's any role of bone scan.
I think bone scan is not really a very useful thing unless you're doing specific labeled scan, and particularly within the first year.
It gives us negative, that if it is negative, then it rules out.
Yeah, but in first year, it's unlikely to be negative. That's why the timing was there. Vijay, you want to say something?
See, first, if you have ruled out all the markers of infection, anything, you know, I would rule out allergy.
Yes,
allergy.
I think that's the point I was trying to make. So if an infection is not an infection, it is metal allergy. The second thing which often confuses in the presentation is, if the patient is moving the knee very well and there is just some pain and some warmth and some redness, the RST is a very common thing in the post-operative period. So don't, you may have set off the false alarms, but be careful about diagnosing infection. But then, like I said, allergy is a very, very, very rare cause. So your first index of suspicion should be for infection. Amit, what are the antibiotics you would recommend for the bacteria which form biofilm?
The ones which normally form biofilms need some sort of glycopeptide or lycopeptide. So if the patient's got a very fulminant infection, then you normally have to use something higher. That means you're looking at something like daptomycin combined with rifampicin, because rifampicin has got very good biofilm penetration.
Yeah, that's right. But the additional thing which I wanted to say from your talk was, now it has been proven that if you give antibiotics before the incision, it does not compromise your pickup of the infection from the site during the second stage, but it might reduce the chances of infection in the second stage. So do not withhold your antibiotics. The current recommendation is, when you are going for second stage and you want to take some samples, do not withhold antibiotics. Go as you would go for any revision, and take your samples. They are not going to be affected by the giving the antibiotics beforehand. Vijay, you talked about the single stage. Now, I want to know, do you believe in any local antibiotic delivery in cases where there is you're going for one stage?
Yeah, as far as local antibiotic delivery, if you're doing a cemented, then you have to mix antibiotics, or you need a cement, cement.
So one is the antibiotic loaded cement.
Yeah, second is you can use Timolan with
antibiotics. I think that's a very important point. Now, actually, more and more studies are coming, and in our center, we hardly ever do any debrima of any kind without putting stimulants. So what our approach is, I'll talk about the osseous defect and the delivery within the bone later, but in the soft tissues,
We have had very good results whenever we use something like a Stimulon with antibiotics loaded in it. Now, Vijay, you have an 80-year-old and you have infection and you go in and you have very well fixed implants. So what are you going to do in this such a case?
Yeah, maybe in an 80-year-old, I will, you know, if I know the bug, then it's going to be a single stage.
You don't know anything. You only know there's an infection. You're not been able to raise the bug. Yeah. Anybody? Any thoughts?
It's been my own personal practice. I'm not advocating it for the past 10 years. I always do a one-stage revision, but it is a part of a two-stage procedure. The patient is consented for a two-stage procedure. So I take the implant out, which is very critical because there is a biofilm on the implant. You can use a new implant or an autoclaved implant with antibiotic, but in local delivery of antibiotics. If it's an 80-year-old patient, I think that's...
Anybody else has got any thoughts? So two views on that, as the experts have said. One is that you can actually put something like a dynamic spacer. So you can autoclave the same femoral component and put a new polyethylene acetabular component, loosely cemented, and let it work like a hip. I have seen Arnold Hansen say that they put a totally new implant as a spacer, loosely cemented, but they can afford it, we can't. So either you can put an Indian implant or you can autoclave and put the same thing. But the reason why I asked this question was that recently there are reports out of the centers in US and Europe where they are saying that if it's a well-fixed implant, you know, you can actually retain the implant. So maybe remove the modular part, so take out the head, change it, and you have a modular cup, take out the liner, put in a new liner, but do not remove the well-fixed component which are osseointegrated because it may be too much of effort in an 80-year-old and would cause a lot of bone damage. On the other hand, if you combine this concept with the concept of high local antibiotic delivery in the form of Stimulon, we have actually managed to control a few patients like that, so I would highly recommend that. Now, Dr. Lee...
problem of putting the implant is that the local delivery of antibiotic reduces because a lot of space is occupied by the implant.
That's right.
So
that's right.
I do not believe. I put just large amount of cement.
You may have a point. You see, the question here is only about patients.
And these patients, they can control even spacer so nicely, put them on brace.
Exactly. No, no, this when there is a fit patient and young patient, you are absolutely right. And the only question here is that we have seen that in the dynamic spacers where we autoclave the components in the knee replacement and just buy a new polyethylene for the patient and we just loosely implant it, so our patients do continue for many years. So the idea here is only if it is not safe or not advisable or you don't want to do a very big surgery. Obviously, the concepts for one stage, like Vijay said, or two stage are well established. But the question here is, would you really say somebody has a solution stem which is now infected? Should you really be taking out a long solution stem in an 80-year-old with all that bone destruction and put them? And I assure you that it will be very difficult to do a single stage there because you will have a big bone defect which will become a contraindication to single stage. So there is some evidence coming up. There may be a role for retaining those components in these patients and try to work around the local this thing. And about
just one point, you know, one problem that we face here in private practice is that let's say you opt for this strategy of doing a liner exchange. Now what happens, the patient comes in for a surgery, they're billed for this surgery, now they spend say about 2 lakhs further having this washout, debridement and liner exchange. Let's suppose it doesn't work and you put them on higher antibiotics. Now they come back to you, say, oh doc, now I spent another 3-4 lakhs over here, and then by now the patient goes into sepsis. So you're damned that way as well. So it's a risk you're running.
You are,
and there's some sort of practical
right.
decision to be made.
Yeah, that's something you should discuss with the patient and take him in confidence, tell him all the options and discuss with him. I understand there will be constraints in your local practice. Now, Dr. Lee, the biggest problem is when to go in again. And I'm sure you have seen it as I have seen that diabetics and rheumatoids, the ESR and CRP refuse to settle down. So what would you think is the correct time to go in for the second stage?
No, you have to, you would have to follow the standard protocol, I suppose. You know.
Yeah, I know, but the standard protocol says that ESR CRP is high and the patient's CRP is 13 and ESR is 30. Now, are you happy going in? Patient is diabetic or has a rheumatoid?
If clinically the signs and symptoms, you know, appear to have settled, then and you can't rely on the ESR and CRP, then I suppose you would then...
Dr. Yadav?
Yeah, clinically, if you know already the organism, if it is not high virulence like gram-negative MRSA, then or clinically, and you can aspirate the joint and see the culture, how so, much percentage of yeah. polys are there.
So the question here poly. Is, the question here is, like he said, that you aspirate, but the problem really arises if the tap is dry, the ESR, CRP are high, and I tell you, I can assure you, this happens very often. The ESR is 30, 35, 40, CRP is 13, 12. Now you have a situation, the patient is a diabetic or it's a rheumatoid. So what do you do there? So I think one option, like Chandrasekhar said, is to go in like a one stage. Go in, if the patient is old, you think, because we have done an exchange of the spacer more than once. So you have gone in, taken out the spacer, washed, debrided, put in a fresh spacer. And what we do is we subject whatever we take out of the joint into for cell sonication. And that has shown us many times that when CRP was high and there was no evidence of infection, when we sonicated the cement spacer, we found the same bug for which the first revision was done. So my personal advice is CRP should be taken very seriously. ESR is mostly borderline. But then sonication is one way. But many times now people are saying that it may not be possible to disrupt the biofilm adequately just by sonication. So they're talking about the laser-generated shockwave disruption of biofilm on the implant. Or they are also talking about DTT, which is the chemical disruption of the biofilm to get the bacteria. Now, a quick question for Buddhadev. You said a watertight closure is a must. What is your choice for a watertight closure?
Yeah, I use a technique which I think is my own. It's based on some logic. I do it in two layers. I do an interrupted closure in extension and a locked continuous closure in flexion. The reason is that, see, if you have done a locked closure, once you extend this knee, it becomes loose. So you need an additional closure to keep it closed during extension. And I think the watertight closure is very important, because a lot of the time what happens is you leave the closure to your assistant and you leave the hall, and I think that's not a good idea. So what starts off as a small, you know, inconspicuous discharge from the distal end of the wound can sometimes flare up into a gross infection. So
can I ask the panel quickly, what are their choice for watertight closure? Because the closure, you know, all of those of you who have worked with Dr. Ranawat, many times anybody will open the joint for him, his fellow, his junior, anybody. But he will stay till the last stitch has been put. So that is just to emphasize to all of you how important it is to close the wound, whereas the big surgeons most of the times think that the implant has been put, so their job is done, so they leave it to their junior. So quick thing about the watertight closure of capsule from Krishna.
So I don't use barbed wire suture, but if you are really looking at a watertight closure, probably that is the way to go.
Barbed wire is a movie or Pamela Anderson. I also liked it very much, but it's a barbed suture, not the barbed wire. But I love it. I think that's what we do. And Chandrasekhar?
I put Vicryl, but closely placed, so there is a no gap.
So it's an interrupted closure.
It is
interrupted
like box
closure.
As we were taught by Professor Bhan, box like that suture.
Yeah,
they overlap.
I think the important thing is, I think let's run through the panel. Yuvraj, how do you close it?
Do it myself, interrupted and continuous, and most important stitch is the last one, where you have to close it properly, other that's the main place where it drains.
Great. Amit?
Few interrupted Vicryls, then continuous running.
Vijay?
Yeah, interrupted 2-0 ethibond and, with a continuous barbed suture.
You have said?
Yeah, what I do is I take the first suture is the most important. This is a meniscal stitch. I learned this from Dr. Briard in France. You know, there's a meniscal stitch which you take and put as a flap. It's like a double breasting of the lower part, because that's where you get most of the leakage. So you put that across and then you run a routine closure.
So that's a very important thing, particularly when you have cleared corrected a very severe varus deformity, there will be a defect in the lower part where soft tissue will not close. So these patients are likely to have discharge, you should be careful. But most people will do an interrupted closure with a continuous running suture all through. And the important thing according to many is you reach the one end and you must come back. So don't let the continuous thing end at the end. Once you reach the end, you must come back with a few sutures before do it. And for many of us, we have been doing this closure with the Barb suture, which is actually a very special suture. And this year, we have also published that in International Orthopedics, our experience of using this. And that is really very good watertight. Now, DPU has also come out with a Strata Fix, but they are like 4 years behind. Because this was launched in India a long time back, was used by general surgeons. Thank you, my panelists. Thank you, audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you.